everybody. Remember me? I'm a camp counselor now, and I've developed some new and improved camp-appropriate dance moves that you can use whenever the spirit moves you, or whenever those little whippersnappers are making you want to lose your salvation. So let's get going, huh? Ready? Here we go. One, two, three, four. We're taking some mana. Put it in the basket. Yeah. Don't take too much, because it'll turn the maggot to get stinky. Woo! Yeah! Start to sweat, because I'm in a fiery furnace. Yeah, can you believe it? Flames licking my body, licking my body, licking my body, licking my body. Okay, here we go. Yeah, we're doing great, everybody. It's in the face, remember? Yeah, here we go. We're just spinning the pit. We're just spinning the pit. We're just spinning the pit. Claw, claw, scramble, scramble, scramble. Claw, claw, scramble, scramble, scramble. And we're breaking. This isn't in the Bible, but it should be. Anyway, stand at attention. Keep those clothes on, let's be modest. We don't want to get too crazy now. Yeah, we're doing it. Just go nuts. And then, same story, but a different action. Yeah, you're doing it. Snip, 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 snip. We're doing it, everybody. Just don't confuse that one with another one with snipping. Oh boy. This is good for all you ravers out there. What's it saying? I don't know. What's it saying? I don't know. I don't know. Many, many, take a little parsley. Means you're in trouble. Yeah. Oh, guys, I feel like I'm gonna be sick. We're just on you. Keep going. You can do it, okay. This one is funny. Kind of disturbing, though, for the Bible. They're laughing at the bald head. Go on up, you bald head. Yeah, and then bears come out, and they tear them limb from limb. They're tearing them apart. They're tearing them apart. Here we go, okay. Don't take your eyes off Jesus, because then you pull out. And you say, oh, up like the Red Sea. And split, and split. We're splitting, we're splitting. Split, split, split. Now, this is important because you could say, I'm a DJ in one of those fancy clubs, right? Like this. But watch what happens when I change the face. Now I've lost an ear. You know, when they betrayed Jesus? Yeah. That's me. Kick the ear. No, kick the ear. Look. Get it back now. Kick the ear. And then put it on or just about healed. Let's get back to some oldies and goodies, huh? Just about what we're trying to down. Salt. Salt. Salt, 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 salt. Just about dead, guys. I can't do it anymore. We're getting there. But then I'm gonna take it down. So take it down. Take it down. Drowning in my own sweat. Drowning in my own sweat. Where is it? We're good. We're good. Alright. Have fun at camp this year, everybody. Have fun at camp.
Thank you. presence of my enemies. Hooray's a hallelujah, louder than the unbelief. Hooray's a hallelujah, my weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
Well, I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise.
Louder,
louder.
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 As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are all about to be fulfilled?" Jesus said to them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, claiming, 'I am he,' and will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines. These are the beginning of birth pains. You must be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, do not worry beforehand about what to say. Just say whatever is given you at the time, for it is not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. Everyone will hate you because of me. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. When you see the abomination that causes desolation standing where it does not belong, let the reader understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let no one on the housetop go down or enter the house to take anything out. Let no one in the field go back to get their cloak. How dreadful it will be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers. Pray that this will not take place in winter, because those will be days of distress unequaled from the beginning, when God created the world until now, and never to be equaled again. If the Lord had not cut short those days, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect, whom he has chosen, he has shortened them. At that time, if anyone says to you, 'Look, here is the Messiah,' or 'Look, there he is,' do not believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. So be on your guard. I have told you everything ahead of time."
Let's pray. Father, thank you for this opportunity that we have to look to your word in the midst of circumstances that can seem like they're spiraling out of control. I thank you for your presence with us. You are faithful, you are loving, you're wise, and you're good. I thank you for this opportunity that we have to look to the future and find not just warning, but hope. Hope in you, and a reminder of the urgency that we have to not just look like your church, but to act like your church. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. I pray that he would point us to Christ. I pray that you would give us ears to hear and hearts to obey him. Thank you in advance for what you're going to do. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, greetings, church. I went back and I counted, and today is the 10th time that we have live streamed our service, and it's the 9th Sunday that our church building has been closed. And I hope and pray that you are redeeming the time and not just sheltering in place, but sheltering in grace. And I'm looking forward to worshiping with you in person, hopefully in the very near future. We are watching and waiting and listening and trying to see when that is going to be, but just a fair warning, even when the building does open, the church is going to look a lot different. And we're going to be okay with that. Normally, we would want to have a crowded room. Now we want rooms that are only filled maybe to a quarter of their capacity or so. And so we're going to be implementing some really neat ideas that I think are going to be really enjoyable for us. And we want coming together as a church to be exciting and fun for the whole family. But for now, I pray that you are continuing to grow in your faith and you're taking opportunities to be the church in your homes, in your neighborhoods, workplaces, and online communities. Most of our church body is faring really, really well, but there are also some among us that are facing some difficult hardships and difficult circumstances. And to me, that's a poignant reminder that our world is not quite right. And our study through the gospel according to Mark is so timely right now because it deals with questions that many people are asking, questions that are on our minds right now. One of those questions are, does this pandemic, does that mean that the end times are here or are near? And I'm not an alarmist by any means, but all those weird preppers and wackos that are preparing for the zombie apocalypse, I tell you, they've been living large in their underground bunkers for several weeks now. And I want to say very clearly, though, that I do not think that this pandemic is a horseman of the apocalypse by any means. I do think, however, that it is wise and it is prudent, especially in times of crisis, that we do understand what is true and what is not true about the future. I've heard it said that a preacher's job is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. And Jesus' teaching on the future does exactly that. You're going to be either comforted or you're going to be afflicted as we look to Mark chapter 13. In the beginning of this chapter, we saw Jesus beginning to teach his followers on the Mount of Olives concerning future things. This is just a day or so before his arrest and crucifixion. And this chapter, it's frequently called the Olivet Discourse because it took place on the Mount of Olives. And it stands out in Mark's gospel because, by and large, Mark, he was a very active writer. He likes events and miracles and immediately this, immediately this, immediately this. And for him to take a whole chapter and have this be Jesus' extensive sermon or teaching on this, it's unique for his book. It's also included in Matthew. It's included in Luke. But it really emphasizes that it stood out to Jesus' disciples and it stood out in their minds, and it should capture our attention as well. And what brought about this whole conversation, one of Jesus' disciples walked into the temple complex and was just marveling over these massive stones and this huge temple building. And he's just fawning over the beauty and magnificence of it. And Jesus shocks his disciples by informing them that this magnificent building, this temple, not one of the stones of the temple would remain. They would all be torn down. And so these disciples, like any good Jew, they are their heartstrings are just tied to the temple, and they want to know, when is this going to be? When is all this going to happen? Because to them, temple and the God's kingdom, they were tied together. You look back at the Old Testament prophecies concerning the future of Israel, and the temple is there. And for Jesus to say it's going to be torn down, that was shocking to their idea of a kingdom. They expected Jesus to establish his rule in Jerusalem. He came in fulfilling all these messianic prophecies. And so the destruction of the temple, it didn't fit into their worldview. It didn't fit into their idea of how the Messiah should reign. And so they wanted to know, Jesus, when are you coming as king? And so Jesus, he doesn't tell them exactly when. He tells them what to expect, what to look for, what signs are going to happen. And chapter 13 is his prediction and his warning of the things to come. And it turns out that the future, it's not all roses. And you don't have to look much past social media or past the evening news, radio, television, newspapers, however you get your news today, to know that the hope for the future is in short supply today. And the worst part is that we're living in a world that is racked by sin, that is incapable of helping itself and stitching itself together again. We're living with the effects of the curse, and we see it every day. Sickness, pain, death, they're all symptoms of our broken world. Wars, earthquakes, famine, plagues, floods, droughts, natural disasters, symptoms of our broken world. COVID-19, cancer, AIDS, Ebola, symptoms of our broken world. So creation is literally groaning under the weight of the curse, and humanity, with all of our collected knowledge and science and sheer determination, we cannot contain the effects of sin. For me, I mean, when I look at humanism, the idea that humanity can perfect itself and continue to evolve into a higher, perfect utopia, the whole idea of evolution, that an organism can become more ordered and complex and advanced as time goes on, it's fundamentally flawed. And I'm not talking about natural selection, I'm talking about the theories of evolution. I was an engineer before I was a theologian, and evolution just, it breaks all the laws of thermodynamics. In particular, the second law of thermodynamics, we're going to go nerdy on all you kids that thought you weren't in school today, but the second law of thermodynamics is the law of entropy, and that basically says that entropy is always increasing. Entropy is disorder, that all systems, they move towards more and more disorder, entropy always increases. For example, if you take a room and you clean that room, over time that room is going to become messy again. Even if you go back in and clean the room, the effort and the energy that you spend to get it clean increases the entropy outside of the room. And so everything moves towards disorder. If you have a vapor in a room, it doesn't form into a ball. It spreads out throughout the room. And so things just move towards disorder. I mean, those of you kids know that. You can't keep your house clean. It just moves towards disorder. But our world moves towards disorder. The galaxy, humanity as a species goes towards disorder. We're not evolving towards physical perfection. We're breaking down as a species. We're not getting healthier. We accumulated knowledge, we have better health care, and so that may have looked like it increases our lifespan, but as a species, we're physically weaker, we're less intelligent than our great ancestors. And I mean, even archaeology has confirmed that our ancestors had denser bone structure than we do. They were stronger, they were faster than we are. I read the church fathers and I'm blown away by their mental capacity to do things that we can only do with the help of a computer today. That we're not evolving towards perfection. We're devolving. We're breaking down. And we're breaking down physically. We're breaking down as a society. We're breaking down spiritually. We're not becoming more and more moral. We're becoming more and more wicked, more and more corrupt. And so the groanings that we are experiencing in humanity in these times now, they are birth pains. They remind us that we're inching closer and closer to end times. And we don't know the exact day. We don't know the exact hour. No one does except God himself. But when you look at the signs, when you read about what is going to happen, you can't help but notice that we're getting closer and closer to that day. It is imminent. It could happen anytime. I mean, listen to the words that Paul gives Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, and tell me if this doesn't sound like today. Paul writes, he says, "But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power." I read that description and it sounds like a summary of today's front page news. We're cruising along on the Titanic thinking that we're too big to sink, and the Bible is screaming, iceberg ahead, iceberg ahead. And we need to listen to those warnings. In the case of the Titanic, there were six warnings that they received on the day of the collision, and all six of those warnings were ignored by the operator, who was too preoccupied with transmitting passenger messages. It's foolish to ignore warnings, and especially when those warnings are from Jesus. So the warnings that were provided with in Mark 13, it's urgent for us today, and it's important that we understand what Jesus is saying. The first 13 verses of Mark 13, it's a depiction of the depravity of human history. You can revisit the sermon from 2 weeks ago, and we're told that there's going to be destruction, there's going to be deception, there's going to be distress, there's going to be people that claim to be messiahs, there's going to be wars and earthquakes and famines and persecution, open hatred of Christians, families are going to be ripped apart. And all these things, Jesus says, it doesn't mean that the end is here, but it means that the end is near, that it's increasing in frequency and intensity, but it's not the end. I mean, Jesus says that very clearly in verse 7 and 8. He says, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is not yet. He says these are but the beginnings of birth pains. So the beginning of the end, it's in verses 5 through 13, and a sign of the end is we're going to see in verses 14 through 23. This section, Mark 13, 14 through 23, it's a very important, it describes an important specific event. It's specifically referred to as the tribulation in verse 19. And it's a unique time that has occurred in creation, and we're told that it's worse than anything that has ever happened in human history. To me, that's astounding, that it's worse than the plagues of Egypt. It's worse than the destruction of the northern kingdom of Israel. It's worse than the Babylonian exile. It's worse than the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. It's worse than Noah's flood. That's bad. And so look at verse 14 of our passage. It says, but when you see the abomination of desolation standing where he ought not to be, let the reader understand. That little parenthetical note, it's the gospel writer's way of highlighting, starring, underlining, as saying this is really, really important. Make sure that you understand. Make sure that you pay attention here. I mean, he's writing out Jesus' sermon, and he has to stop mid-sentence in order to speak directly to you and I and the billions of people over two millennia that would read this text and be told that we need to pay attention to these words. This is really important. So seeing the abomination of desolation, it's going to be the sign that these things are going to happen. So the question is that who or what is the abomination of desolation? In Matthew's account, we're told that this is a specific reference to what was promised or what was foretold in Daniel. And so Jews would have recognized this from the book of Daniel. Daniel mentions specifically the abomination of desolation three times, Daniel 9, Daniel 11, and Daniel 12. And so in Daniel, we're told that this individual ruler would come into the temple and would abolish the sacrificial system, and in its place would offer a profane sacrifice, would want to be worshipped himself, that would leave the temple desolate. Now, at the time of Jesus, when the abomination of desolation, the Jews would have had a specific event already in their minds. They thought that what had been promised in Daniel had already occurred. That both the historian Josephus as well as the first book of Maccabees note that in 168 BC, a ruler named Antiochus IV entered Jerusalem, slaughtered a pig, which was to the Jews considered an unclean animal, scattered its blood throughout the temple, and then sacrificed it on the altar, desecrating the temple and the sacrificial system of the Jews. And he attacked Jerusalem, and on this attack he killed 80,000 Jews and took another 40,000 as slaves. Antiochus called himself Epiphanes, which means God made manifest. The Jews like to call him Epiphanes, which means the madman. They considered Antiochus Epiphanes the abomination of desolation that Daniel spoke about. But here, now in Mark 13, hundreds of years later, Jesus is speaking of this event as something that would happen in the future. And so it's not that event from 168 BC. And so this is really important. That would have perked up the Jews' attention as well. The disciples would have been wondering, what is he that he's talking about? Well, some people say, well, what about the destruction of the temple in 70 AD? Could Titus have been the individual that Jesus was referring to? And I don't think so. It's true that the temple was destroyed in 70 AD, but there wasn't a substitution for the true worship with profane worship. And the religion was not completely desecrated at the time. These two events, while significant, while foreshadowed, while promised, they could be foreshadowing of this event, but I don't think it's the ultimate fulfillment of what Jesus is talking to. And I'm going to give you a couple reasons. First of all, 2 Thessalonians 2, it refers to a coming day. It says that the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. That's 2 Thessalonians 2, 3, and 4. A future event. Revelation 13, 5 through 8, it says, speaking about the beast was given a mouth uttering haughty and blasphemous words. It was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. It opened its mouth to utter blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling. And it says that all who dwell on the earth will worship it. Okay, that obviously didn't happen with Titus. That didn't happen back in 168 BC as well. And so I believe that I believe the Apostle Paul, John, and the revelation of Jesus Christ, they're speaking of a distant future event. And so we have to piece together all these pieces to try to figure out what it is that Jesus is talking about, what it is that he wants us to understand. And so at the foundation of theology, there's a foundational belief that God's word is absolutely true. It's consistent with itself. And so when the Bible makes a prediction and it hasn't happened yet, or it hasn't happened in the way that it says in the Bible, we're either reading the Bible wrong or this event still has yet to occur. It's going to happen sometime in the future. Sometimes we see partial fulfillments or foreshadowing, but everything that God has written will come to pass. God says in Ezekiel 12:28, the word that I speak will be performed. And so I know there's a lot of different beliefs about end times, and there's a lot of disagreement even over well-intentioned Christians. One of the reasons why I don't classify myself as a Reformed or a Calvinist is because I read the Bible and I see clear, direct promises for Israel. And the Reformed Calvinist tradition tends to see the church as supplanting and overtaking Judaism. And I see these promises for Israel, Jerusalem, the temple, and the Jews, which haven't yet taken place. And so I see them as distinct, the church and Israel distinct from one another, and I don't believe that God is done with Israel. The Jews, they're at the center of what God is referring to here in Mark 13. They have a prominent place in the revelation of Jesus Christ. And when you look at the history of the Jews, the pogroms in Russia, the Holocaust, their birth pains, but the worst is yet to come. Jeremiah 30, it refers to the tribulation as the time of Jacob's distress. Jeremiah writes, he says, "Alas, that day is so great. There is none like it. It is a time of distress for Jacob, yet he shall be saved out of it." There's hope. Zechariah 13, it talks about a time when two-thirds of the Jews will be killed and only one-third left alive. Zechariah 13, 8 through 9 says, "In the whole land, declares the Lord, two-thirds shall be cut off and perish, and one-third shall be left alive. And I will put this third into the fire and refine them as one refines silver and test them as gold is tested. They will call upon my name, and I will answer them. I will say they are my people, and they will say the Lord is my God." When you look at the revelation of Jesus Christ, Revelation 12, it speaks of Israel as a woman with a crown of 12 stars representing the 12 tribes of Israel. And this woman gives birth to a male child that will rule the nations with an iron rule, speaking of how Christ came out of the Jewish people. It says that Satan tries to destroy the son, but the son ascends up to God and to his throne. And then it says that Israel is going to be attacked and forced to flee in the wilderness and for a period of 1,260 days, exactly 3.5 years. God protects this remnant of Israel. Revelation 13 speaks of the beast that utters blasphemies against God, that is allowed authority to exercise authority for 42 months, 3.5 years. Israel deceived with peace for 3.5 years by the Antichrist. Two witnesses preached for 1,260 days, 3.5 years. Then the beast kills the witnesses, desecrates the temple, and Jesus says in Mark 13, "Get out if you can," when you see this happening. That Israel as a nation will experience tremendous tragedy before they experience salvation, before they look to the Lord and they say, "He is my God," and God says, "These are my people." And this is why Jesus says, when you see the abomination of desolation, this is it. Get out. In verse 14, he says, "Let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let the one who is on the housetop not go down nor enter his house to take anything out. And let the one who is in the field not turn back to take his cloak." It's going to be a terrible time. And alas, for women who are pregnant, for those who are nursing infants in those days, he says, "Pray that it may not happen in winter, for in those days there will be such tribulation as has not been from the beginning of the creation that God created until now and never will be." Now, there are some people that believe that the church is going to go through this tribulation. I mean, after all, Jesus said, you know, "In this world you will have much tribulation." So they take that statement and say, "Well, we're in the tribulation. This is tribulating times." And Jesus did say you will experience tribulation, but there's a huge difference between the tribulation that we experience from the world and the tribulation that the world experiences from the hand of God. The tribulation that Jesus is speaking about, it's God's judgment upon the world. It's referred to as the great tribulation, the pouring out of God's wrath and judgments upon the earth. And again, I have a lot of good Christian friends that disagree with me on this, but I do not believe the church will experience the great tribulation. I believe that the church will be raptured before the start of the tribulation, and so that's called pre-trib. That the church is raptured before the start of the tribulation. And there's a lot of reasons for that, but I want to give you a few. First of all, Jesus says that no one knows the day or the hour, but here in Mark 13, we see that if Jesus only returns at the end of the rapture, everybody's going to know the day, because he said when you see the abomination of desolation, and so the timing, it's all laid out. You have the number of days, you know exactly what's going to happen, and so, okay, here's the event. Boom, the clock starts. 3.5 years, everybody knows the day. And we're told that nobody knows the return of Jesus. And so I believe that the imminent return of Jesus that it's talking about is the rapture, when Jesus comes for his church. Okay, it's not Jesus physically coming down to earth. He doesn't touch down. It's different. The rapture is different from when Jesus physically returns to earth, ushering in his millennial kingdom. We can read about this in 1 Thessalonians 4. 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 through 17, it says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who were left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. And then in 1 Thessalonians 5, it goes on to differentiate those who experience sudden destruction from which there's no escape to those that belong to Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 5:9 says, "For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ." 1 Thessalonians 1:10, we're called to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. And so that's the main reason why I believe in the rapture, that I think the Bible clearly teaches it. I think it's also what Jesus speaks about in John 14, where he says, "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you that I may go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." And so the taking you to myself is different than Jesus bringing the church with him when at the second coming. At the rapture, Jesus takes believers from the earth to heaven, to his Father's house. In the second coming, believers return from heaven to the earth. So that's a big reason for the rapture. You also have the book of the revelation of Jesus Christ as well. By the way, there's a little trivia for you. The book isn't called Revelation or Revelations. The full title is The Revelation of Jesus Christ. When you look at the book as a whole, you have chapters 1, 2, and 3 of the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's the church is there. Chapters 4 through 18, which describe all the judgments of the tribulation, there's no mention of the church. Israel's all throughout those pages, but there's no church. And then in chapter 19, the glorious appearing of Jesus coming on a horse, faithful and true, in righteousness, judging and making war, he comes with his bride, the church. You also have verses like Revelation 3:10, where Jesus speaks to the true church of Philadelphia. And he says, in verse 10, he says, "Because you have kept my word about patient endurance, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world to try those who dwell on the earth." He says in verse 11, "I am coming soon." And then in chapters 4 through 18, you have this description of the tribulation. I mean, you can lay it out. If you look at a timeline of history, okay, you have the past, and you have the church age, and then after the church age, at some point, the imminent return of Christ, you have the rapture, which is described in John 14, 1 through 3, and Revelation 4 and 5, when Christ returns for his church. And so he meets them in the air. And then you have a period that's laid out. You have a 7-year tribulation, and it's separated into two parts. You have the first 3.5 years and Revelation 6, chapter 6 through 7 and 8 and 9 describe the first 3.5 years. And then in the middle, you have the abomination of desolation. You have chapters 10 through 12. And then you have the great tribulation, the second half of the tribulation, where the Antichrist breaks his promise with the Jews, and you have this persecution, you have this destruction, 2/3 of Israel be lost, and the third that remains turns to the Lord, and they're protected, they flee to the wilderness, and these events are spoken of in chapters 13 through 16. And then after this, Christ returns, the second coming, and he comes with his bride, the church, and you have this battle, and it ushers in the millennial kingdom, and at the end of that, you have the great white throne of judgment described in Revelation 20 through 22. And so the coming of Jesus Christ is described in chapter 19. It's a horrible time, but it's when Christ cleans up and makes things right and defeats his enemies. And so the rapture is when Jesus comes for his church, and the second coming is when Jesus comes with his church. The rapture comes before the tribulation. The millennial kingdom begins after the tribulation. And so we have to differentiate between God's kingdom and the millennial kingdom. Okay, we're living in the kingdom. We're not living in the millennium right now. But the days of tribulation that come before the millennial kingdom, the Bible tells us they're absolutely horrible. You have three sets of judgments. You have seven sealed judgments. You have seven trumpet judgments during the first 3.5 years, and then seven bowl judgments described during the last 3.5 years of the great tribulation. And so it's right where Jesus says back in Mark 13, verse 20, he says, "But if the Lord had not cut short the days, no human being would be saved. But for the sake of the elect whom he chose, he shortened the days." So God set a time limit on these final judgments, 1,260 days, 3.5 years. And we may experience troubles, tribulations from the world, but we haven't experienced anything like the great tribulation that the Bible describes, the wrath that God pours out upon the earth. It's a great tribulation, and we're not in that tribulation now. So in verse 21 of Mark 13, Jesus says, "If anyone says to you, 'Look, here's the Christ,' or 'Look, there he is,' do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and perform signs and wonders to lead astray, if possible, the elect." We saw a little bit of this 2 weeks ago, that there's deception everywhere. And Jesus says, hey, the tribulation period, it's going to be no different. The elect won't be deceived. If they were deceived, they wouldn't be the elect. But there's lies and there's deception that's in contrast to the truth. And there's a reason for that. If you accept the truth, you have to accept the truth giver. And people who reject Jesus will have to embrace lies. And so that's why Jesus says, verse 23, says, "Be on guard. I have told you all things beforehand." Watch out. Watch out for deception. Recognize it. Reject it. There's good news and there's fake news. Right? You can only know what's fake news when you know what is true, what is the good news. God's word is good. The word gospel literally means good news. And so Jesus gives us this look into the future, not to entertain us, but to warn us. And so the question is, why? Why should we care? If the church is raptured, like you say, why should I even concern myself with these predictions? Why should I even pay attention? Why is it important for me? And there's a very simple reason. And the reason is because we're on a rescue mission. I really like the idea, the illustration of the difference between a cruise ship and a battleship. On a cruise ship, the people, they're there to relax. They're there to be comfortable, to be fed very well. They're there for entertainment. That's the whole purpose of a cruise ship. That's why people get upset when they want their money back when cruise ships run into trouble. They didn't board the cruise ship for trouble. They didn't want an adventure where they would be tried and tested. They purchased their ticket for an opportunity to forget about trouble. Whereas a ship that is built for a distinct purpose, you know, for instance, the USNS Comfort was recently in the news, sailed into New York Harbor over a month ago as a hospital ship to help rescue New Yorkers dying of COVID-19. And the people that sailed on that ship into that harbor, they were under no illusion that they had a job to do. They knew they weren't on a pleasure cruise. On any wartime vessel, every single person has a unique and an important job. There's no wasted space, that they don't take along extra people just for the fun of it. Every single person knows their mission. Every single person knows their place. Every single person knows their part in accomplishing the mission. And so you see the contrast between a cruise ship and a battleship. And sometimes I think that the American church, we think that we're on a cruise ship. We forget that we're in a war. and that the time is short, and that their people are perishing, and there's no time to waste. And so Mark 13 is Jesus responding to his disciples. They had a tourism mindset. There are these country boys coming into Jerusalem, visiting, look at all these stones, look at all these wonderful buildings. And they're like the guys that are arranging the deck chairs in the Titanic. They're missing the urgency. They're missing the peril. They're missing what is before them. And Jesus is crying out, iceberg ahead, iceberg ahead. It's not so much to save his disciples from the devastation to come, but so that they might do their part in rescuing others from the devastation to come. Yes, things were going to be difficult for them, and they would be tried and tested, but ultimately, when you look at God's plan for the world, that awful things are coming for his people, and awful things are coming for the world, and so we have our part. The world is heading for an iceberg, and the majority of the people that you pass every single day are drowning in sin. They're in desperate need of God's salvation. And so the question before you and I right now is, are we going to join the ranks of God's battleship church that is tasked for a rescue mission to save as many lives as possible? Or are we going to have a consumerist entertainment attitude and live life as though we're on a cruise ship? Do we serve as part of the church, or do we think that the church exists to serve us? I like that example of the Titanic. And I love history, and when you read the stories about the Titanic, we find out that as the Titanic was sinking, the operators, they tried to find another ship close enough to come to its rescue. So a little after midnight, they were able to contact the Carpathia. It was a small British ship about 58 miles away. The message to the Carpathia said, SOS, SOS, come at once, we've struck a berg. So the operator on the Carpathia reported the message immediately to his first officer. They raced in the room of Captain Arthur Rostron. They woke him from sleep, and when he heard the message, he said, all right, tell them we're coming as fast as we can. The captain had ordered full speed ahead, but the Carpathia had a top speed of only 14 knots. At that speed, they knew it would take them about 4 hours to reach the Titanic. And so Captain Rostron, he decided we can do even better. And so he ordered all off-duty stokers to the engine room, get every ounce of steam to the boilers. You turn off all the hot water throughout the ship, all power to the engines. And so from its top speed of 14 knots, it began to increase speed to 15, 16, 17 knots. They got 3 knots faster than her top speed on their way to rescue the perishing. Despite all that was happening on the ship, one thing wasn't overlooked. The second officer noticed it and recorded this, and then every person on the bridge noticed it, that the Captain Rostron, he was at the back of the bridge holding his cap an inch or two off his head, his eyes closed, his lips moving in prayer. So they did reach the place where the Titanic went down, but unfortunately over 1,500 people died that night because they could not get into the lifeboats. Of those that did get in the lifeboat, 700 were rescued, all of them by the Carpathia. Not one other ship arrived in time. But it turns out that as the Titanic was sinking, there was another ship. The lights of it were actually visible on the horizon. And so the Titanic, they tried to signal this ship by Morse code, by blinking lights, by rocket flares. The name of the ship was the Californian. The Californian crew reported seeing the lights of the ship that night, but they did not receive Titanic's radio messages because the radio had been turned off. The Titanic sent up 8 white rockets, and the crew of the Californian reported seeing 8 rockets. 3 times the crew reported these rockets to their captain, but it was the middle of the night, he was asleep, and he woke up and said, hey, the rockets probably mean nothing. Crew wondered why a ship would send up 8 rockets in the middle of the night without a purpose. And so unfortunately and tragically, the Californians stood by while 1,503 people drowned. It could have rescued them. It could have been there even quicker than the Carpathian, but the captain did not believe there was a problem, and he was unwilling to be bothered. There's another tragedy about the Titanic, that there was enough life jackets for all 2,208 people, and almost everyone was wearing one. That night, 1,503 people perished, including passengers and few crew. And the next morning, 300 dead bodies were pulled from the sea, and all 300 of those bodies were found floating in their life jackets. So even without the neglect of the Californian, those 300 people, the tragedy is that they died needlessly. It turns out that as people were boarding the lifeboats, they didn't fill the lifeboats to capacity. Of all the lifeboats that were launched that night, there were 472 lifeboat seats that were unused. More than enough for those 300 people floating in the icy waters. Of all the lifeboats that headed away from the sinking ship with room to spare, only one lifeboat turned around. So I read this passage in Mark 13, and I have to ask myself, am I so content in my own rescue that I refuse to turn around and do what is dangerous and uncomfortable in order to save others? People are perishing. God has given us the only means of salvation through Jesus Christ, and the question is, will we put ourselves at risk in order to save others who are dying? Jesus left the comfort of heaven, and he put himself at risk in order to save others, and his rescue mission cost his life. He gave his life on a cross so that you could be saved. If you're heading for that iceberg of God's judgment without knowing that you would be rescued from the tribulation to come, you can be saved right here, right now. If you don't personally know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you want to be forgiven, and you want to walk with him. I want you, you can make this change in your heart right now. Unfortunately, none of us can save ourselves. We all need Jesus and the salvation that he provides. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You can come to the Father through Jesus right here, right now, by surrendering your life to him. If you want to make that decision, I want you to take a stand, to lift your arms in the air, to connect your heart with your head, to call out to Jesus. And I know I can't see you, but Jesus can. So put your hands in the air, stand up as a way to tell Jesus, I'm here and I surrender. And I would love to pray for you if you're standing or raising your hands right now. Let's pray. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for those that are standing or raising their arms out and surrender to you, declaring their desire to be right with you, to enjoy fellowship with you, to have a new start, to be forgiven by you. Father, I pray that you give them the strength to walk with you. And so if you're standing or raising your hands and surrendered to God this right now, I want you to say this out loud from your heart. You can pray to Jesus right now. Say something like this. Lord, I give you my life. I know that I'm a sinner. Forgive me. I believe in Jesus. I believe he died on the cross. I believe he rose from the dead. I turn from my sin. I turn from my past. I turn to you as my Savior, and as my Lord. I want to live for you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you just pray that prayer and ask Jesus to change your heart, I would encourage you, tell someone. You can make a stand for Jesus. You can message me. You can comment online. I would love to connect with you and share with you how you can grow in your faith. You not only belong to Jesus, you belong to a family. And it's a family that has been given the most precious gift on the planet, rescue through the finished work of Jesus Christ. So don't be a cruise ship. Go be the church.